We're back to This Evening Now, and in 35 minutes, James Garner stars in The Rockford Files. That's after Film 83 with Barry Norman.
Over you, loving you the way I do, my little one. Sleep well. Merry Christmas.
Good evening, and thank you, Mystery Voice, for that truly awful Christmas greeting. Have you any idea who that was? Well, yes, you probably have, because you're a knowledgeable lot. But if the name temporarily escapes you, hang around, for all will be revealed later. Now, in this programme, the last of the year, I'll be reviewing the Yuletide blockbusters. Well, in some cases, I use the word loosely, for, after all, this is the season of goodwill. So I'll be talking, for example, about Jaws 3D, Brainstorm and Krull. And in addition, I'll be looking ahead to next year and the keenly awaited return of dear old Clint Eastwood as Dirty Harry in Sudden Impact. But first, Trading Places, in which, as a special Christmas offer, you get two movies for the price of one. A very good comedy and a not very good farce. Let's start with a comedy. Wealthy Ralph Bellamy bets his equally loaded brother, Don Amici, and how nice to see these venerable senior citizens in such sparkling form, that environment is stronger than heredity. In other words, that if pompous young commodities broker Dan Aykroyd could be made to trade places with street hustler Eddie Murphy, each would settle easily into his new role. Done, says Amici. And so a devious plot is set up that results in Murphy inheriting Aykroyd's job, house and butler, the magnificent Denham Elliot, while Aykroyd finds himself on the streets, penniless and ritually stripped of his credit cards, which in American society is a bigger disgrace than being drummed out of one's regiment. Now, before I go on with this, let me tell you a little about the precocious Eddie Murphy. He's 22, he made a notable impact earlier this year in his first film, 48 Hours. He's recently signed a $15 million contract with Paramount, and he is by several lengths the sharpest and funniest element in Trading Places. Here he is talking about the difficulties of moving from a thriller like 48 Hours into a comedy like this one.
You know what's strange? When I went to do 48 Hours, that's the first film I ever did to people here. You know that already. When I went to do that movie, I was like, oh, how am I going to make this transition from comedy to serious acting? Because there were scenes where I had to be serious. And I went and I did it, and it was really easy. And I was like, huh, there's nothing to this acting thing. It's easy. And then I come to the set here, comedy is so much harder to do.
Who's that? What you want?
Police. We've had some complaints about con men pretending to be blind and crippled.
Oh, I'd love to help you, man, but I ain't seen nothing since I stepped on that landmine in Viet Cong back in 72. It was rough, very painful.
You were in Nam, so were we. Where?
I was in, Sang Bang, Dangan. I was all over that place, basically. A lot of places.
What unit were you in?
I was with the Green Beret, Special Unit Battalion's, Commando Airborne Tactics, Specialist Tactics, Unit Battalion. Yeah, it was real hush-hush. I was Agent Orange, that was my name, Agent Orange, Special Agent Orange, that was me.
Airborne, huh?
I can see! I have legs! Oh, shit! Look at this! Man! I can walk! Jesus! Praise Jesus! Ah, I appreciate this. Oh, this is beautiful! I can't believe... Thank you! I don't know what to do with... Glory be to God! Praise Jesus! Look at me! This is too much! I can't believe it! I am beautiful! This is... I can't thank you! First Moses, now this! God, Jesus! Oh, thank you! Look at me! I'm so happy. Oh, God. Look at me. This is too much. What a happy day. What a happy day.
I don't think I wanted to be like Richard. Richard Pryor was like my idol when I was young, but I didn't want to be like Richard. I wanted to get the same response that he got from people. That's what I wanted. I idolized the way that I like the response he would get. I wouldn't like see him and say, "Ah, I want to be just like that." I would see him and say, "Whoa, I want to make the people do the same thing he does." And that was my idol when I was coming up.
Well, after that, back to the film, directed incidentally by John Landis, who made Animal House and American Werewolf in London. The first half is a clever and stylish comedy about greed and the misuse of power and wealth, a throwback in a way to the social satires of Preston Sturges. If you can accept the machinations of the wicked old brothers, then the rest is entirely credible. Even the introduction of a golden-hearted hooker, beautifully played by the leggy and effervescent Jamie Lee Curtis, who takes the bewildered Aykroyd under her wing. Unfortunately, it's hard to escape the impression that at some time somebody said, "Hey, there aren't many belly laughs in this, fellas," because suddenly the film switches course and becomes a rather predictable revenge caper, marred by the introduction of moments of illogical and therefore pretty unfunny farce. It does get back on course at the end, but only just. Nevertheless, the first part, well, let's be generous and say the first two-thirds of Trading Places are a good deal more amusing than anything else around at the moment, and it's worth seeing for Eddie Murphy alone. But now the moment when Jamie Lee Curtis unwittingly plays her part in the destruction of Dan Aykroyd and loses him his fiancée.
Excuse me. I'll see you later. We'll have lunch.
How'd you like to make a fast 100?
I just got out. Oh, come on, what are you trying to do, entrap me right here in the middle of the police department? You guys must be getting desperate.
No, this is for...
Stealing from your friends at the club, Lewis? Heroin, Lewis? Have you lost your mind? Mother wants me to call off the wedding, and so does Todd.
Todd? What does Todd have to do with it?
You've been fired from Duke and Duke. They're preparing charges against you for embezzlement.
Embezzlement? I've never stolen anything in my life. Listen, Penelope, I swear to you, on my honor, with Almighty God as my witness, I am not an angel dust dealer.
Lewis.
I've been looking everywhere for you, baby. Listen, Lewis, I'm hurting, baby. I just need a show.
Please.
Lewis, who is this person?
I've never seen this woman before in my life.
Don't say it to me. Come on, baby. Just a dime bag.
You lying, filthy, disgusting creep!
Grand. Great. Thanks a lot.
It was a joke. Your friend said it would get you off.
You mean someone told you to do this to me?
Yeah, and he paid me $100, too. It's right over there.
Now then, if you're under the impression that Christmas is about mirth and joy, goodwill to all men, mince pies, turkeys, and a bit of a sing-up in church, then you obviously don't go to the movies very often. Christmas in the cinema is about horror and terror and sudden death, and these things are provided this year, in some measure anyway, by Jaws 3D, the latest and, alas, feeblest in the series. There's no Roy Scheider anymore to give the performances a touch of class, and there's no seaside resort of Amity either. This time we're transported to Florida's SeaWorld, where, just as a new tourist attraction, the Undersea Kingdom, is about to be opened, a great white shark gets trapped in the lagoon and keeps body and soul together by ruminatively chomping up five or six people while everyone else rushes around squeaking with panic. The humans involved in all this include Bess Armstrong as a plucky marine biologist, Dennis Quaid as her engineer lover, our own Simon McCorkindale earning a few dollars for Britain as an intrepid underwater photographer, and Louis Gossett Jr., who won the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor this year in An Officer and a Gentleman, and must be very pleased that he did, because nobody's going to win anything for Jaws 3D. And what about the 3D? Well, even that's disappointing. If you can't make a 35-foot shark look terrifying in three dimensions, and director Joe Alvis doesn't, then forget it. A few severed limbs float towards you out of the screen, looking a bit like the Sunday joint enjoying a quiet swim. But generally speaking, the effects aren't up to much. At best, Jaws 3D might keep youngish children quiet for a couple of hours, and in the Christmas holidays, I suppose that's worth bearing in mind. However, here we are at panic stations after the shark has been sighted.
Get out of the water! 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 Get out of the water!
Talking of the Christmas holidays, well, I did mention them a couple of minutes ago. If you're thinking, as one naturally does at this time of year, of nipping over to California for a winter break, here's a tip for you. Why not try the Universal Tour, one of the longest-running hits in Hollywood? In 1915, Carl Laemmle started a company which today is the largest movie-making facility in the world, Universal Studios in Hollywood. Having a keen eye for a quick profit, Uncle Carl, as he was known, not necessarily affectionately, realised that the ramshackle collection of warehouses, stages and outdoor sets was almost as big an attraction as the films themselves, and so began the Universal Studios tour. Not all the silent films were shot on a stage. Universal Studios were located in the San Fernando Valley, which was merely one big orange grove 65 years ago. The original back lot was so busy that the western area was called Six Points, Texas, because six films could be shot there at the same time, and often were. Indeed, more movies have been filmed in this one area than in any other single spot in the world. But with the coming of sound and the consequent need for silence offset when the cameras turned, the tour was discontinued. In the early 1960s, however, Universal decided to bring it back as a big and lucrative tourist attraction. Film fans are bussed around sets that have done service throughout the history of the movies. This house, for instance, belonged to Ronald Reagan in Bedtime for Bonzo. After he moved out, Marcus Welby, MD, moved in. Doris Day and James Garner lived across the street in The Thrill of It All. And Gregory Peck's house in To Kill a Mockingbird was later occupied by Cheech and Chong. Then, too unforgettably, there's the Psycho House. Some of the best-known buildings are on Universal's New York Street, which also served with great versatility as Los Angeles in Earthquake and as East Berlin in Torn Curtain, though it was converted back to New York for Thoroughly Modern Millie. Little Europe has been the home of Dracula, Frankenstein and the Wolfman. Allied troops and German soldiers marched along the same cobblestone streets in All Quiet on the Western Front, while the steps of the Roman Senate in Spartacus's time are just round the corner in the middle of the back lot. The Universal Studios tour has changed along with the film industry. In particular, special effects, the mainstay of many big modern movies, are provided and built to work not once, but every day. This 12,000-gallon flash flood, posing a mock threat to the visitors, was actually used in Earthquake. On the other hand, the Jaws exhibit was purpose-built to cash in on the success of the shark films. Here, as the tram goes through an alpine avalanche, the floor, walls and ceiling rotate. Well, sort of. Each year, more than 3 million punters take the backlot tour, and that makes Universal Studios very happy. Actually, I've been on that tour and it really is rather fun, especially the bit where the same cast and the same director reenact the same scene from an imaginary TV soap opera every hour, on the hour, every day of the week. However, on to the results of this month's competition. The films you were asked to identify were adaptations of George Bernard Shaw's Caesar and Cleopatra, Ernest Hemingway's A Farewell to Arms, and Boris Pasternak's Dr. Zhivago. And what those writers had in common, of course, was the fact that they all won the Nobel Prize for Literature. The winner of the competition was Miss A. Stewart of Falkirk, who wins a bumper bundle of books plus a film 83 sweatshirt, the last of the year. And incidentally, those three films can all be seen on video. But now, back to the beginning of the programme and that dreadful song, warbled, if you hadn't guessed already, by one Archie Leach, better known as Cary Grant. An unkind rumour has it that he recorded it one year as a Yuletide message to save the expense of Christmas cards. Well, there is a Hollywood definition which says that eternity is sitting in a restaurant with Cary Grant and James Stewart, waiting for one of them to pick up the bill. But since neither you nor I are likely to have that experience, let's not dwell on it now. The thing is that Cary Grant will be 80 in January. It's not fair. How can anyone look that good at nearly 80? You know the secret, don't you? He's been married 5 times, so obviously what we all need to keep us young is the love of a good woman, and another good woman, and another good woman, and another good woman, and another good woman. Anyway, to celebrate the momentous birthday, the BBC is running a season of Mr. Grant's films, including on December 29th, Suspicion, in which he co-starred with Joan Fontaine.
Have you ever been kissed in a car before?
Johnny.
Johnny what?
You mustn't joke with me. I'm no good at joking. I don't know how to flirt.
Oh, I'm not joking. I'm serious. Have you ever been kissed in a car?
Never.
Would you like to be?
Yes.
Well, well. You're the first woman I've ever met who said yes when she meant yes.
What do the others say?
Hanged if I know anything but yes.
But they kiss you.
Usually.
Have
they? Have they what, monkey face?
Have there been many?
I'm afraid so, quite a few. One night when I couldn't fall asleep, I started to count them. You know, the way you count sheep jumping over a fence? I think I passed out on number 73.
Are you always frank with them like this?
No, not particularly.
Why are you frank with me? Because I'm different?
No, it isn't that. I'm honest because with you, I think it's the best way to get results.
I hope I'm not saying the wrong thing.
Yes, well, didn't they all? Well, in a film career that began 52 years ago, Cary Grant has been consistently one of the most polished and downright watchable leading men in Hollywood, a superstar long before the word was coined. In such films as Arsenic and Old Lace, She Done Him Wrong, The Philadelphia Story, and Bringing Up Baby, he was the perfect light comedian. But for me, he was also the most satisfying of Hitchcock's heroes in thrillers like Suspicion, of course, Notorious, North by Northwest, and To Catch a Thief, opposite the archetypal ice-cold Hitchcock blonde Grace Kelly.
The first time I saw you was on the beach at Cannes. You swam ashore from a motorboat driven by that little French girl.
You got an opener? Mm.
Thank you. Do you want a leg or a breast?
You make the choice.
It was just 2 days before you showed up at the hotel as Mr. Conrad Burns.
Uh-huh.
Just over from America. Did you swim?
Well, naturally.
Oh, now don't be disappointing and sound like Mr. Burns.
I can only be myself, Miss Stevens.
Then be yourself, John.
I prefer Conrad.
No, you can't be serious. And I think it's about time you called me Francie. I have to look out for Mother. They've tried to steal her jewelry before. So when I read about the, you in the paper, just a small item, but I picked it up. I was sure Mother would catch your eye.
Mm-hmm. Well, she did, because I liked her. Well, so far, Miss Stevens.
Francie.
So far, you haven't said anything that sounds even remotely clever.
Well, stick around. The next thing I noticed about you was something remarkable.
Yeah?
All evening long, you only looked at my mother, never at me.
I kissed you, didn't I?
I kissed you.
I certainly wasn't looking at your mother then.
You were thinking about her. Otherwise, you never would have let me say goodnight so easily.
I'm a gentleman.
A rough lumberman from the big northwest.
I must remember to yell timber occasionally.
And at this point, what can one say to Cary Grant except Merry Christmas, a Happy New Year, and many happy returns? Oh, and as for the singing, don't call us. Right, well, back to the festive offerings and Krull, which is a sort of galactic pantomime directed by Peter Yates. On the planet of Krull, a young Prince Charming, Ken Matthews, has fallen heir to a besieged kingdom, the besiegers being the Beast and the Slayers, who are not, as you might have supposed, a punk rock group. Actually, they're a bit less terrifying than that. The Beast is a sort of omnipotent evil being, and the Slayers are his metallic, robotic followers. Anyway, here the Slayers attempt to kidnap Prince Ken's beautiful bride, Lisette Anthony.
Here.
Now, despite Prince Ken's excellent impersonation of Errol Flynn, the Slayers succeed in their kidnap attempt and whiskily set Anthony away to the Beast's lair. So, with the aid of Freddie Jones, as a wise man named In-Ear, pronounced as in, not in there, In-Ear, and a band of frightfully nice escaped criminals, Prince Ken goes off to rescue his popsy and save his kingdom. What makes things particularly tough is that the Slayers are equipped with deadly laser beams, while the goodies are armed only with swords. Although against that, the prince does acquire the glaive, an ancient and symbolic weapon, which looks like a circular version of one of those Swiss Army knives. You feel it could do anything from opening a can of baked beans to extracting horses' hooves from Boy Scouts. Ah, you are saying to yourselves, a wondrous weapon, eh? Not unlike King Arthur's Excalibur, or the Force in the Star Wars saga. And you are right. Krull is a very derivative film, for which reason the American critics were extremely sniffy about it. But they're a cynical lot. And if you accept the picture simply as a fairy tale, the emphasis being on magic rather than sci-fi technology, it's pretty good family fun. The Beast's lair is an armoured fortress which, inconveniently from our hero's point of view, changes its location every 24 hours, and the panto element is sustained by David Batley as a kind of buttons figure, a comic poltroon whose magical tricks usually go wrong. Here he is with Prince Ken, who's about to enlist his merry men.
Robbers. Men. We don't know yet whether they're robbers.
Faces that ugly could only belong to robbers. Don't worry, I'll turn them all into pigs.
Besides, you're short about 90 men.
Let's just kill them and be done with it, Torquil.
Saffron! I don't kill men without good reason.
Nor do I. And be thankful for it. You're escaped prisoners.
Everyone. Thieves, bandits, fighters, and brawlers.
Desperate men.
Desperate as you'll ever see.
Good. Those are the kind of men I need.
You know, I said earlier that the Beast and the Slayers were not a rock group, but on second thoughts, I'm not so sure. When you finally see the Beast, the first thing that strikes you is that he has lips exactly like Mick Jagger's. Oh, and the philosophical and optimistic message of Krull is that power is fleeting, love is eternal. Oh, really? Would that it were so. But now on to fantasy of a more modern, which is to say more technological kind. Brainstorm was the late Natalie Wood's last film. In fact, she died tragically before it was finished. Although, to be fair, there's no hint in the picture that her part was anything but complete. Miss Wood plays the estranged wife of Christopher Walken, who, with his mistress and scientific colleague Louise Fletcher, is the inventor of a brainwave device that enables people to experience the physical, intellectual, and emotional sensations of another person. Mr. Walken and Miss Fletcher, being pure scientists, are developing this invention, of course, for the benefit of mankind, but their grasping opportunist boss, Cliff Robertson, has signed a contract with the US military, who plan to use the device as a weapon in psychological warfare. Well, you get some idea of the power of this machine when a scientist watches a porno videotape on it and all but expires in a bout of extreme orgasmic pleasure. The crux of the plot revolves around a tape Miss Fletcher has made on the brainwave gizmo while dying of a heart attack. Miss Walken and Miss Wood want this tape, the military want to stop them getting it. Before all this is resolved, there's a fair amount of tension and excitement, although in the end you are left wondering idly what all the fuss was about. Brainstorm is a thing film rather than a people film, in that the humans are subsidiary to the technology. But the performances, that of Louise Fletcher in particular, are more than adequate, and the effects, especially in 70mm Super Panavision, are often very effective. Given her choice, I doubt if Natalie Wood would have chosen this picture as her final monument. But for those interested in high tech, it has quite a bit to commend it. And there's an interesting, if not exactly inspiring, view of heaven as consisting exclusively of computer graphics, fireworks, and electronic music. Here, though, is Cliff Robertson being given his first demonstration of the revolutionary new machine.
Congratulations.
For what?
Al said you had a breakthrough.
Alex, dear, it was just another test. A little better, but still crude.
Lillian, I know you can do it. I know you can do it. I like a demonstration. I want you to knock my socks off. Remarkable. A true, one-of-a-kind scientific breakthrough. God, wonderful. We'll have to tell the division heads. And Karen, maybe we can modify it and simplify it even a little more, huh?
Oh, yes. That's already in the works.
Good. We'll need to make a demo tape. We want to show the potential for travel and education and news. Can we do that, Mike, in the conference room?
We could pump it right through the phone.
Excellent. And thank you all. You've blown communication as we've known it, right out of the water. You know that, don't you? And I'm very proud of all of you. You blew my socks off.
There's a man whose socks come off more easily than most. A little video news now, largely for the benefit of those with a house full of children to entertain. You may well be wondering how to keep the kiddies amused after they've become bored with watching such tasty morsels as Driller Killer in the House of the Undead or Zombie Flesh Eaters Gangbang. Well, if so, may I draw to your attention the fact that Rank Video are releasing a series of adventure flicks from the Children's Film and Television Foundation, including such stirring and non-polluting tales as The Battle of Billy's Pond, The Boy Who Turned Yellow, and The Excellent Friend or Foe. These, taken with a periodic fix of popcorn, fizzy drinks, and chalk ices, should keep most discerning young movie buffs happy for a good while. Well, what do the rest of us have to look forward to in the cinema? Not necessarily at Christmas, but in the early part of 1984. Well, there are quite a few potential goodies on their way. For a start, there's Gorky Park, Michael Apted and Dennis Potter's adaptation of a brilliantly imaginative thriller written by Martin Cruz-Smith and set in Russia. Make a note of that one. Then there's Yentl, produced, directed, co-written by and starring Barbara Streisand. I haven't seen this yet, but I suppose there are other people involved too. Daniel, Sidney Lumet's film based on the Rosenberg spy scandal of the 1950s, should also be with us quite soon. This one was taken from a book by E.L. Doctorow, the author of Ragtime. And there's an updated remake of Scarface, the old Howard Hawks classic, this time directed by Brian De Palma and starring Al Pacino as a fugitive from Castro's Cuba, wreaking havoc on the American way of life. But of all the upcoming movies, the one that must stand the biggest chance of doing a bomb at the box office is Sudden Impact, wherein Clint Eastwood reappears as Detective Harry Callahan, known affectionately to his mates as Dirty Harry, for the first time since The Enforcer in 1976. Well, that was a long time ago, but as you can see, the fuzz, like leopards, rarely change their spots.
All right, folks! Did real good with that cop. Now I want everything. Money, watches, rings, everything! Quick, move!
You coming with me, Mom? We're gonna have us a little party, huh?
What you doing?
Every day for the last 10 years, Loretta there has been giving me a large black coffee. Today she gives me a large black coffee, only it's got sugar. A lot of sugar. I just came back to complain. Now you boys put those guns down.
Say what?
Well, we're not just gonna let you walk out of here.
Who is we, sucker?
Smith, Wesson. My day.
Don't do it, son. Don't do it. Finally, 1984 looks like a pretty good year for Bizet, not that he's in much of a position to appreciate it, and more specifically for his opera Carmen. Peter Brook is offering us three versions, each with a different heroine, and you may well have seen the first a week or so ago on Channel 4. Jean-Luc Godard is about to chip in with a modern version called First Name Carmen. And Carlos Saura, who made the impressive Blood Wedding, is also getting in on the act with a film of Antonio Gaddi's flamenco ballet version of the story. So tonight, I shall bring Film 83 to a close with a clip from the Carlos Saura film. It's a sequence in the cigarette factory with Carmen causing trouble. Well, a touch of culture will do none of us any harm. I'll be back on January the 2nd with my choice of the films of the year. But until then, may I wish you all a very Merry Christmas. Goodbye.
There's action and adventure in some of the all-time greats this Christmas on BBC One.